we've got, and I'm going to say hello again.
Hello.
I'm Rachel Bernstein, and tell me about your name, Coet. Is that exactly
Rachel,
how to say it?
My name is Coet.
Coet.
First name, and people say, what is your middle name? And I say, with a first name like that, you don't get a middle name. That name came out of Eastern Kentucky. Had an uncle named Coet, and I had one other distant relative, like a second cousin, whose name was Coet. And I've seen it one other time since that, but they all came out of Eastern Kentucky. I've never seen it anywhere else.
How interesting.
So that's where it came from.
Okay.
I was the third child of 10 children my mom and dad raised in Eastern Kentucky. He was a coal miner. And my dad had only gone to the fourth grade in elementary school, dropped out, had to farm, had to work on the farm, wasn't able to go to school. My mother had completed the eighth grade, and that's as far as they ever got in school. But my dad, even though he worked manual labor all of his life in the coal mines and some other jobs, but he insisted that his children get an education. So we all went to high school, and only me and my oldest brother, out of the 10, there was only two of us that did not go to college, and that was me and my oldest brother. So he got 8 out of the 10 to go to college.
That's very determined.
He was. He just said, you've got to have an education. Children, he said, you've got to have an education because in the future it's going to be much more needful than it is today. You know, he says, you've got to have an education. So I did not go to college, but the school teacher where I live there in Kentucky, he talked me into it. He said, if you're not going to go to college, he said, go into the service. They will teach you a trade and it'll be good for you. So I was going to go in the Marine Corps. And he said, no, he was in the Marines and he was on Iwo Jima during the war, and he said, the Marines, he said, it's dirty in the gutter all the time fighting. You know, he says, go in the Air Force or the Navy one. He says, they've got good schools, they'll train you. So I joined the Navy, and they trained me to be an aircraft electrician.
Huh.
And it worked well for me.
Pretty skilled.
Yeah.
So before we get to that, just tell me a little bit more about when you were growing up, one of 10 kids and a coal miner father in Tennessee.
Yes. Kentucky.
Kentucky.
Eastern Kentucky,
sorry,
yes. Decoy, Kentucky. A little small community. And we were so far back in the community, the only road we had was like a dirt road for miles. And then it would go to a gravel road. And then finally you get to the blacktop just before you get to town. But it was like 2.5-3 hours drive to get to the closest town where there was a high school. So while we had a elementary school in our community of Decoy, there was no high school that we could go to. Had two teachers for all 8 grades, a man and his wife, wonderful people, good teachers, and they'd have a row of students in each grade, and they would be teaching one row of students, 4th or 5th grade or whatever, in the 6th grade, so they'd all be teaching different things, different subjects, and he would just talk to that row while the others were doing their work.
Right.
And it worked out great, and
it must have been a very special teacher to
they
be able
were,
to.
They were, both of them, his man and his wife, and they were just wonderful people, Mr. and Mrs. Lionel Duff. And anyway, in order to go to high school, of course, my dad was insisting that we get an education. We had to go to a boarding school in Hindman, Kentucky, which by car was like 2.5 hours drive away. Couldn't ride a bus. They had no bus service in there. So we stayed at this boarding school called the Hindman Settlement School. And we boarded out there. We would work there, like you had to work 50 minutes a day, and then you had to work a half a day on Saturday. And we would board out at that school. They had the boys' dorm, the girls' dorm.
And your parents didn't have to pay because your work?
They had to pay a little something, but it was for a little, just a very minor amount. My dad could afford that, you know, it wasn't much.
Mm.
But since we worked there, that paid for our room and board, and so my parents had to buy some of the books that we had. Most of the books were provided, but they had to buy some of them, you know. But it's mostly, they cost them very little because we worked there. And then we'd work a month during the summer. We were out of school for 3 months, June, July, and August. And we had to sign up to work one of those 3 months at the school to help pay for our boarding costs when we came back to school. So it worked good for us. And
So that's amazing. So your father, even though they didn't have a lot of money, they were able to send all of you to high school?
Yes.
To this boarding school?
Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. And all 10 of us went to that. The one oldest brother did not graduate from high school, but all the other 9 graduated from high school. And 8 of the 9 all but me went on to college, and so it worked out great.
Must have been a decent high school.
It was. It was a good school, a small school, but it was a very good school, and worked well. Yeah. And but I had wonderful
parents. Took you under their wing and advised you to go.
Yes, that was my school teacher. When he found out that I was thinking about going in the Marines, he said, "Coet, you really don't want to do that." He said, "You need to go either in the Air Force or the Navy one," because he knew the background. And he said, "They have really got some good schools," and he said, "They will teach you a trade, and if you're not going to go to college, you're going to need a trade." And sure enough, he was absolutely right. And when I went off to the Navy after I got out of high school, actually I worked for like 6 months up in Indiana, lived with my brother and sister-in-law, because there were no jobs in Kentucky. Of course, my dad wouldn't even think of us going working in the coal mines.
I was just going to ask you, did he have a strong feeling about that?
Yeah, he said,
that?
"No, you can do better than that," he said. So he said,
"Was he in a union?"
He helped get a union in where he worked there, and this was probably in the late 40s, early 50s, but I remember he helped get organize the United Mine Workers at the coal mine, the tip of where he was working, where they processed the coal. He helped get the union in there. And he was always grateful for the union, and he thought that John L. Lewis was the greatest thing ever coming down the turnpike, you know. And I asked him later on, after I got involved in the union, years later, when I became a union representative, I asked Dad later on, I said, "Dad, what did you like best about the union?" He said, "Son," he said, "the pay got much better." He said, "I really like that." He said, "The benefits." He said, "To be able to have a paid vacation and some other benefits that we got, health care and some things," he said, "that was wonderful." He said, "You know what I like most about it?" I said, "Tell me." He said, "What I like most about it," he said, "for the first time in my adult life," and he's like 40 years old, or maybe a little over 40 at that time, in his 40s when he helped organize and get the union in. He said, "For the first time in my adult life, I was treated like a human being." He said, "Up till that time," he said, "that in the coal mines," he said, "slate would fall in and crush a man." He said, "They'd just wheel him out and bring another person in. They didn't care about safety. They had no," but he said, "the union helped bring in safety." But he said, "The dignity, them treating us like human beings, was the greatest thing about the union." He said, "I loved it." So he was grateful for that. He was a wonderful man. Good parents, just taught us to work hard and to love our country and treat people right, you know, like you want to be treated. And
did they stay in?
They lived there all their lives. That's the only place they ever lived, was right there at Decoit.
Really?
Yes.
And any of their kids end up there?
One younger brother is living there now in the old home place, but all the others are outside. Some still live in Kentucky, but they're all over different states, you know. And the one younger brother, just younger than me, he was in Vietnam during the war, and flying as a mechanic on helicopters, and he's now flying as a corporate. He's the chief pilot for a company up in Minnesota, flies a corporate jet all around the world, and doing great. Yeah.
So flying, the flying bug.
Yes, yes, and I flew.
Must be in there.
I said in there that I flew after I got out of the Navy and went to work. I flew long enough to get a private license, and then I went under the GI Bill and flew under the old Piedmont and got my commercial rating to fly commercial. But I never did anything with it. It got so expensive, and we were sending our kids to a Christian school, and I had to make a choice. I'd keep flying or send my kids to a good school, and I chose to send my children to a good school and gave up flying.
Before we get there, you don't have the children yet. You've just gone in to the Navy and immediately signed up to be trained as a...
Yes, I really wanted to be a pilot. And they said, "Well, you really didn't score high enough on your ARI and your GCT test or whatever, you know." So I said, "Well, what do you suggest?" They said, "Well, you qualify to be we think you would make a good aircraft electrician. And we'll train you to do that." I said, "Let's get on with it." So that's when after boot camp up in Illinois, Great Lakes, Illinois, they sent me to Jacksonville, Florida to train to be a aircraft electrician. And they trained me to do that, and they shipped me from Jacksonville, Florida to NAS Oceana at Virginia Beach, and I stayed there for the other almost three years I had left in the Navy. I stayed there at Virginia Beach and worked on airplanes until I got my 4 years in, and then I got out of the Navy.
Were you tempted to stay in?
Never.
To be up?
Never.
Not a scrap?
The Navy was great. I loved it because of the training that I got, and they tried to get me to get up, to re-up. They said, you know, you've advanced from a boot camp to an airman to a third-class petty officer to a second-class petty officer, and they said, we want you to stay in the Navy. And I said, no way. It's not me. It's not my life. I just don't like it. You know, I like what the Navy's doing, but it's not me. I just don't like the Navy. And they said, well, the recruiter says, well, you'll have to talk to the commanding officer. I said, fine, I'll talk to the commanding officer and tell him the same thing. You know, sure enough, he had me come in. He says, Combs, he said, you're a good man. Why don't you stay in the Navy? I said, because I don't like the Navy. I mean, it's good for me. I've done good, you know. And it's, he said, yeah. He said, you don't have one single mark in your record, not a single bad mark in your record, you know. And he said, you've done good. You're a second-class petty officer. And he said, we'd like to keep men like you in the Navy. I said, no, thank you. I'm not, this is just not my thing, and I will be getting out as soon as my time up. And he said, well, I guess it's no good for me to talk to you. I said, Captain, you're right. I admire you for what you do, but this is not my life. So I will be getting out when my 4 years is up. And I met my wife while I was in the Navy. I met her at Virginia Beach, 1962, April 1962. And we got married in April of 1963. And I had 2 years left in the Navy before I would be discharged. And I told my wife, Linda, I said, you cannot get pregnant because I don't want anything keeping me in this Navy. And if I have one or two children, I said, that may tempt me to stay in where I've got a job rather than get out and find another job. So I said, you cannot get pregnant till I get out of the Navy. So we made that happen.
You made that.
And she didn't get pregnant until I was out of the Navy for about a year and a half or so.
So when you got out, did you want to stay in that neck of the woods?
No, we liked the Virginia Beach, Norfolk area. And my wife had family there, and I had parents still living in Kentucky. So we kind of went in between. We went to Roanoke, Virginia, and I put in an application at the General Electric Company and got a job as a wireman working at General Electric. And I worked there for about a year and a half, and that's I joined the union there, represented by the International Union of Electrical Workers, the IUE, and just after a few months, 3 or 4 months, 5 months, I was elected as a shop steward, and I worked there as a shop steward, and at that time it was...
Was it a closed shop?
No.
Did everybody? Well, I
wouldn't
think so.
In Virginia, you could not negotiate closed shops because you could have people working in there. But in Virginia, which was a right to work, what we call a right to work for less state, you could not have the shops where everybody had to be a member. But I joined immediately because it was just my style. When I first got out of high school, I went to work up in Indiana at this little plant, Winco plant, and I joined the union there. And we had a sit-down strike while I was there to resolve some grievances and worked on the night shift. And the manager would not talk to us about these problems. So my brother and my uncle were representatives of the local union there. And they said, we know how to get them to talk to us. We'll shut the plant down and we'll sit in the plant until they come and resolve the problems. So sure enough, one night at a given point in time, they shut down all the lines, production lines where we were making these products. Roofing housing products, and we went in the break room and sat down, probably almost 7,500 men, and we told the superintendent we're not going to work until the plant manager comes in here and resolves the grievances. And he came in, mad as he could be, and finally things got calmed down, and he started talking, and our guys started talking. They resolved all the issues.
Really?
And after a few hours, we went back to work and resume things like nothing had ever happened and work good, you know. So we got problems resolved there. So later on, when I went to work at GE, I was already, union was in my background. It was no problem, you know. So I joined the union there and became a shop steward for the IUE. And we had one of the funny stories was we had a little, I had a supervisor, really a good guy, but we had two grievances against him. So it wasn't any big things. It was just a couple of small problems that we thought were violations of the contract, and I had written grievances against the supervisor. and they were going to transfer him to another department. So I got a new supervisor that came in out of engineering. He was about my age, and like his early 20s, and he was really a no good person, because the first day he came in, he found out I was the shop steward, so he calls me into his office and he says, "Combs," he said, "I hear that you've got some grievances against Linkus, the other foreman." I said, "Yeah, there's a couple in the system." And he said, "Well, I'm going to tell you right now," he says, "my position is going to be the same as his on those issues." I said, "Well, that's okay. We'll just let him go to the hearing and we'll try to get him resolved, you know, so it's no big deal, you know." And then he leaned across the desk to me. He's smoking one of those big old long crooked cigars. He leaned across the desk to me and he says, "I'll tell you what, too," he says, "I'm going to go to the top in this organization and I don't care who I have to step on to get there." I was fresh out of the Navy and I used language then that I don't use now. And I looked back at him and I said, "You sorry SOB," and I didn't abbreviate. I said, "I'm going to do everything I can to keep you from making it to the top." So I made it my purpose for the next 30 days, every night when I get off work, I'd go home and before I'd go to bed, I'd write a grievance on some issue that was going on, and for 30 days I had grievances against this guy. So it was getting a bottleneck in the grievance because you had to hear him every so often. I think we had 3 different levels in the plant. And at that time, you could not go to arbitration on a grievance because GE wouldn't agree to it.
Mm-hmm.
But we could strike on the issue. So at that time,
You didn't have to manufacture them, I guess. He did enough.
Oh, yeah. There was enough going on.
There was enough cause.
I could always find things to write a grievance. No, it wasn't. This was not just fabricated things, you know. This was things that he would do that would happen in the shop that wasn't in accordance with the contract. And so I would charge him with violating a certain section or article of the contract and write it up on a piece of paper and present it to him, you know. And then we couldn't resolve it. He had to go to a superintendent, and then he had to go to the plant manager to be resolved, you know. And the system was getting kind of bogged down with all these grievances. And once it went to the plant superintendent, if we didn't get it resolved, then it was assigned a docket number, and you could strike on that issue. You couldn't go to arbitration, because if GE says, "No, we're not going to resolve that matter, you know," then we had the option to either let it die or could strike on it, you know.
That's your only option.
So from that point on, every time he would come in there, and he was just notorious for giving our people a hard time. You know, we had, in my department, we had a paint shop, and we had assemblymen that worked on assembling the control units on it, and we had wiremen like myself that would wire these industrial control units, and then we'd move them on down the line for another department to do something, and so on until they went all the way through the plant. And he was just notorious for coming in there because he wanted to get to the top, and he thought if he whipped everybody in shape and really cracked the whip, that he could get to the top real fast, you know. And so when he did these types of things, I would find some article section of the contract that he had violated, and I would file a grievance against him. And the system was getting bogged down, and when he got to the grievances, got to the top, they'd be assigned a docket number, and the guys knew what we could do then. If there was some issue come up that we didn't like, he was doing something, we would give him a docket number and we'd go out on strike, just maybe for a half a shift. It may be coming at time for lunch at 7:30, 8 o'clock in the evening, and the guys would come to me and they'd say, "You see what he did over in the assembly area, what he did to those guys over there tonight?" And so they'd tell me about it, you know. They'd say, "Can we go on strike?" They say, "Have you got a docket number?" I said, "Oh yeah, in my toolbox, I have several docket numbers." So we'd have a little meeting among ourselves there. We'd get ready to go to lunch, you know, and we would vote in our shop to go on strike. So I'd go by and tell
you
my supervisor.
You didn't have to go any further
no,
up in the union.
No,
that was
we could do it
right
there. Right
there
since it was our issue in our department, we could do it ourselves, you know. So I'd go by and tell him. I'd say, "Hey, boss," I said, "docket number 3127, or whatever it was, we're on strike." He said, "What's the problem?" I said, "Docket number 3127. That's all I had to tell him. We're all clocking out as he's coming up there. He's trying to find out what the problem is because he's got to go tell somebody. My group is on strike. And we leave the plant. And when you do that, you shut down the whole assembly line process because it bottlenecks right there. And we'd come back the next day like nothing happened and go back to work. Of course, we've missed a half a shift's work, you know. We've lost pay. we kept doing that week after week. We would do that every
few
days.
You didn't get punished?
No, they can't do anything for you because you're, you know, it's a legitimate strike, you know.
Right, right.
They don't resolve the issue. You have a right to strike on that issue, you know, or you just let it die, you know.
Right, okay.
Can't do anything to you. And we drove them nuts. And after 6 months, they put him back in engineering because they said he's not suitable to be a supervisor. I said, if you had asked me that, I could have told you that on day one because he's a fruitcake. He's a nut. And anyway, but I enjoyed my time with the union there. It was a good bunch of people to work with. You know, but GE was tough. They just, of course, we were tough too. We had to be tough to put up with their shenanigans, you know.
Well, it sounds like they came to realize.
Yes.
You were right and he wasn't.
Yeah.
So they may have been tough, but they weren't all crazy.
Right, yeah. And I don't know whatever happened to this guy, but he wasn't suitable to be a supervisor. He wanted to get to the top and he didn't care who he had to step on to get there. I wanted to make sure that he didn't get there on my watch.
And what percent organized was this plant or your section of it?
I think in our particular department, I think everyone in there was a union member. There were some departments that may just have a few stragglers that would not join, but it was almost, I'd say, for that plant, we probably had 90-95% of the people were
really?
Union members in there. Yeah, so it was only a few people
mm-hmm.
for whatever reason. They had a bad experience somewhere with the union. They wouldn't join, you know, but it was 90-95% unionized in there. Good, solid people.
And you were the shop steward there?
Yes.
For?
The International Union of Electrical Workers, IUE.
Mm-hmm. For 65 and 66?
Yes.
Is where we are.
Yeah, and after about a year and a half, there was an opening came for a job down in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard. This was in late 1966, and my wife and I, we had our first child born there in Salem, Virginia, our oldest daughter. But we really wanted to get back close to her family down at the Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Virginia Beach area, so there was openings coming. They were hiring people. Civil Service was hiring a lot of people because of the Vietnam buildup. They had to fix a lot of ships.
Right.
So they was hiring people, and I went and put my application in to be a electrician in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard. And with my background being trained in the Navy, and of course my wiring experience there at the GE plant, they hired me in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard as a journeyman marine electrician. I'd never been a marine electrician in my life. So I was hired in there, and when I got in the shipyard there, it came under the Metal Trades Department. We had like 16 different unions in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard, and they were all under the Metal Trades Council, which was part of the Metal Trades Department. And our union, at that time, I was in the electrical shop, and it came under the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, so I immediately joined the IBEW and became one of their members. I was not real active in the union while I was there in the shipyard. I was there about a year and a half, but I was a member during that whole time. And then there came an opening. I didn't enjoy working on the ships because it was a lot of hard, manual, heavy labor pulling big cables from one end of a carrier or a battleship to the other, you know, just pulling cables through bulkheads and just a lot of heavy work. And I'd been used to working on airplanes where they have much lighter wires and much easier work, you know. So I wanted to get back working on airplanes. So there came an opening, another ad in the paper, I guess. I saw where they were hiring across at the Norfolk Naval Air Rework Facility, another civil service job. They were hiring electricians over there, aircraft electricians. So I put my application in, and they immediately got me to work over there. And first day I was there, they took you around for the indoctrination, introduced you to everybody, and they introduced me to the shop steward, Francis Reynolds, and that was the Machinist Union, International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers. And so the next day, I got through with all my indoctrinations that day, so the next day I go back. And of course, that's civil service, it's all open shop, you don't have to be a member, you know. So I go back to Francis Reynolds, I struck out my hand. I said, Francis, I met you yesterday, you're the shop steward, and I said, I want to join your union. And he liked to fell out backwards. He said, I don't normally have people want to come to me to join the union. So I usually have to chase them down and twist their arm and get them to join that way. I said, well, I'm union, and I want to be a part of the Machinist Union, you know. And he gladly signed me up as a member in 1968. I think it was May of 1968. And within a few months, I was elected as a shop steward. And then within about a year and a half, I became the assistant chief steward. And then probably within another year, I was asked to run on a ticket to become the assistant chairman of the shop committee. This was a big bargaining unit, bigger than I had been in before. It consisted of it was about 4,000 people working there, overhauling these Navy airplanes, repairing them. And so we had, even though they weren't all members, we represented about 4,000 people in there. So we had like 75 shop stewards. I think we had 8 or 9 chief stewards. We had assistant chairman and chairman of the shop committee. We had a union office on the base in the shop. The government provided us with a union office, you know, to go there and do research for grievances and arbitrations and things like that.
And that was all machinists, or that was, again, the metal trades?
No, that was all machinists there. Over at the shipyard, the metal trades had the certification for representation, and all the different trade unions were involved over there, like 16 different local unions from different internationals were involved in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard under the Metal Trades Council. Here at the Naval Air Rework Facility in Norfolk, that was all came under the Machinist Union. So we had it all there with the, we represented all the blue-collar workers. And
were very many of them returning vets from Vietnam?
Not at that time, because they were still in Vietnam at that time when I first went there. We had some returning vets, but not a lot that I recall. You know, there were some people that came back and went to work for civil service that had their, and you did, it, under the hiring system, I know I used that because I had 4 years in the Navy, and that gave me some extra points for on the application to get hired in, you know. So
right.
If a vet come and someone who had never been a vet came, and they had the same qualifications, the veteran would get the job because of the extra points they had because of serving in the military, you know.
But were there African-American workers?
Yes, not only workers, but some of them
and
were
electricians.
Some of those were, we had them as electricians, but there we were representing all the different trades. So we had African-Americans that were shop stewards, chief stewards, and very, very active in the union, yes.
That's a time of great turmoil. Was there not? There was not turmoil in the union.
You're talking about as far as race relations,
civil rights,
Vietnam War protests.
All of those things are sort of all going on at the same
time. Yeah, that
was
seemed like that was outside. The protests were all outside. We didn't have that. We did not know of that. It seemed like that was off in other cities. You know, California,
far away from you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Washington and New York and places like that. You know, we didn't have that there in Norfolk. I never recall having any protests going on there. And as far as race relations, we had a good relationship with the African-American community. And like I said, a lot of them were shop stewards and chief stewards. And then when I ran to be the assistant chairman along with the chairman, I had a lot of them that were, they were in my corner. They knew my background, I'd worked in there and served as a shop steward and assistant chief steward, and I had a lot of them that were supporting me, you know. And when we ran, we did a full-blown campaign to get elected, you know, and had a lot of support among the black members of the union. So it worked great.
So are there any other grievances or things that stick out from your time as this shop steward? And
well, one thing there as a shop steward, and I really had a good supervisor, Mr. Barnes. And the reason I thought he was a good supervisor because he was the kind of person that probably didn't know the electrical work like we did because he'd been out of the trade for so long. But he would let us do the job that we were supposed to do. You know, we knew how to do the aircraft electrical work, but he would get whatever tools or supplies that we needed. We just say, "Hey boss, we need this or this to get the job done, you know." He said, "I'll make it happen." And he'd know where to go on the base,
mm-hmm.
for whatever shop. If we needed a special tool made, or we need special equipment, testing equipment, something like that, he would go make it happen. So he was the kind of supervisor that would assist you in getting your job done to the best, you know, to the best possible way. And was a great supervisor. Anyway, I filed a grievance on him. And really, he hadn't had a grievance filed in probably in years, and I think it had to do with overtime. He had not assigned the overtime properly. You know, it was supposed to have been done, and they're supposed to rotate the overtime among the qualified people to do it. You know, and he had not done that, so I filed a grievance on him, and he just kind of, I guess it kind of hurt him because he had this grievance on him, you know. And after a couple of days, he came to me and he says, he would not resolve it. I asked him to, I think, to pay a guy the time that he had lost that he should have been paid for overtime, you know, and he refused to do it. And he says, he come back to me and he said, are you going to resolve this grievance or is it going to go forward to the next step, you know? I said, boss, if you can't grant the demands we got on there, it's going to have to go forward, you know. It's a grievance. It hasn't been resolved. And so anyway, we eventually got it resolved, you know, but he was a good guy. He was a good supervisor. It's just that we had he had not followed the contract in assigning the overtime, and we had a grievance there, and we had to get it resolved, you know, and we did.
So you did take it to the next step?
Yes, yes, yes.
And did he forgive you?
Oh, yes. He was always a good, he knew that. He knew I was doing my job as a union steward, and he had to do his. He thought as a supervisor, you know, he just wasn't accustomed to going by the rules where they were supposed to abide by, you know, but he fell in line and did a good job after that, so he was a good guy.
Huh.
Yeah.
So then this election, you're going to be elected to be Grand Lodge rep?
No, at that time, the election we run there in the plant was for the assistant chairman of the shop committee.
Ah.
So I ran it with another guy and got elected. And a year later, I ran, I think those positions, maybe they lasted 2 years. And I was the assistant chairman, and I was doing the work of the chairman. So a year later, they asked me to be on a team that I didn't want to be on. You pick teams to run, a slate of team to run on for chief stewards, shop stewards, chairman, assistant chairman, what have you, and officers of the local, you know. And they asked me to be on a team, and I didn't like the team that they had made up. So I said, no, I can't do that. And they said, well, you're going to be off of our team, so... Then some of the other guys come and talk to me, and they said, you need to run as chairman. I said, well, I really don't want to run for chairman because I hate to run against the guy that asked me to be the assistant chairman just the last go-round, you know. He said, well, if you don't, you're going to be on the outside looking in because he's got his whole slate, and we want you to run against him. So anyway, almost all the chief stewards came to me because they knew I'd been doing a lot of the work. And so they came to me and asked me to run, and a bunch of the shop stewards, and they agreed that they would support me, so I reluctantly had my name put in and ran and was elected as the chairman of the shop committee.
When you have that position, are you still working as an electrician, or are you doing union work
most
of the time?
We're still civil service employees, but they had a provision in the contract that the employer would allow the chairman and the assistant chairman sufficient time off work to deal with grievances and problems, whatever, you know, whatever it might be. And by the time you get to be assistant chairman, that's full time in the union office.
It is.
Chairman the same way. So even though we were paid as government employees by the contract,
you were dealing with union business.
We were dealing with union business on a full time. We'd work some, but it'd be very little, you know. And then we'd work overtime if they need overtime work. We'd do come in and work on Saturday, whatever, you know. So we did. We'd still work overtime, and some other time if we were caught up on our union work, didn't have problems that we had to deal with, you know. But with 4,000 people, there was always seemed like some problems to deal with, you know. But I did that for like another couple of years, and
so that's in the late 60s to the early 70s.
That's into the 70s now, because I think I served 1 2-year term as assistant chairman, and then 2 years as a chairman. I think I ran and got elected again. So I think I was on my second term as chairman of the shop committee. And one of our business reps, we had two business representatives there in the Norfolk area at that time. One decided that he no longer wanted to be a business rep, so he decided he was going to quit, go back into the shop, work with his tools again. A real good guy, Bill Barnes. And the director asked me if I would come on and fill in the rest of his term as a business representative. I said, well, I really never thought about it, you know, but if you want me to, I'll go do it temporarily. So we had to take a leave of absence from work and go do my job, go do the job of a business rep. So I did that, And then I ran and got elected. I asked the, after a few months when the term was up, I asked the, I knew I was going to have to stand election for business rep. And I asked the guy that was in there before, I said, do you want your job back? Because if you do, I won't run against you. You know, he said, no. I said, I really don't want to be business rep again. So he was happy not to be a business rep. So
he wanted to go back to the shop,
yes,
as well?
Yes, he did. He went back and stayed in the shop until he retired. So I ran and was elected as a business rep, and no opposition. And after, that was in, let's see, I first went on in January of 75 as a new business representative appointed and filled out the remainder of the term. And then I got elected one time, and then in October of 77, I was asked to go on the international staff as a Grand Lodge representative. Went on, gave up my job as a business rep and went on as an international representative.
So before we get there, tell me a little bit about the job of a business rep.
Okay, so
as
a business representative, we negotiated contracts, handled grievances, arbitration cases, and I remember the first arbitration case I had to do on my own. I asked the director to go sit in with me on that because even though I had been in on several arbitration cases in the past, I had never handled one as the person that prosecuted the case. So I asked the director to come and sit in with me, and he did. He came and sat in, and he was there for like 2 hours, and he got over and whispered in my ear. He says, I'll see you later. He says, you don't need me. So he left, and I handled the case and went on from there, you know. But everything was relatively smooth during that time. I don't know of any big issues, you know. I handled lots of arbitration cases, negotiated contracts, and did some organizing for new shops and things like that, you know, but that was...
So this is the time when Red Smith becomes president of the IAM.
Red was president when I first went in there as a business representative. He was president because I got one telegram from him. I had a group of people, we at in District 74 there in Norfolk, Virginia. We had a group up at Wallops Island, Virginia, over on the Eastern Shore for NASA. We represented several contract groups over there where they launched small rockets for NASA. And I had a group out on strike over there. We had a contract negotiations with a service contractor at NASA, and we couldn't get the thing resolved, and we went on strike. And I got a telegram from Red Smith because we put pickets up on the main gate and all the gates. We want to make sure that anybody coming in there saw that our particular group of employees were on strike. And they have a provision by law that they designate what they call a neutral gate. And anyone having business to do with that contractor will have to go in and out of that gate. And that's the only gate you can put pickets on. So I got a telegram from Red Smith to remove all the pickets that I had at Wallops Island on all the gates except the one for the neutral gate where all the workers and vendors had to go in and out that had dealings with that particular company. So I reluctantly agreed to do what the international president ordered me to do, but it worked out good. We got it resolved in a few days and everything went on well. We got a contract, yeah. But pretty much uneventful as a business representative, you know, just doing the normal things that one would do to negotiate contracts.
And how big was your territory?
Well, we went from Elizabeth City, North Carolina. We had a government facility down there. The old Coast Guard had a base down there where they worked on Coast Guard planes. We represented those people. And then Wallops Island, Virginia. And then in between, we had Hampton, Virginia, Newport News, Virginia, Norfolk, Virginia, Virginia Beach, private industry locals and things like that. We had a fairly large Bendix plant in Newport News, Virginia. And that was pretty much the territory that I covered when I was a business representative.
So you travel, you're on the road during the week and...
Yeah, but not away from home at night because it was close enough where we could go take care of the business during the daytime, excuse me, and be back at home at night. So it was not that we'd have to stay overnight, you know. Sometimes at Wallops Island, I would have to spend the night over there, stay overnight, and because we go up there, we had like 8 to 10 different contractors, and there would be different issues. So we'd go up for a local lodge meeting, we'd try to take care of the grievances and whatever we had to do while we're there. Sometimes we'd spend one night there and go back, you know. But then I went on the Grand Lodge staff in October of 1977.
And was that something you were looking forward to? Did it come as a surprise, or...
Well,
was it a dilemma about
it was
whether to do it or not?
It was a surprise for me, really. I didn't know. I'd never really thought about going on. I really never wanted to be a business representative. It wasn't. I didn't seek to be a full-time union representative. It's just that the opportunity presented itself. It was offered to me, and the pay was better. And I decided, well, I like what I'm doing, you know, and being a business representative was very much like what the chairman of the shop committee did. You handle grievances and arbitration cases and trying to get people organized into the union, signing up new members, you know, so it's similar to what I was doing already, and I enjoyed doing that. And I had an opportunity to go on as a labor relations representative. They wanted me to go into management to be a labor management representative while I was on the base. And that was the same time I was being offered the job of a business representative, and I liked working with the employees and handling grievances on their behalf rather than I did sitting on the other side of the table. So I chose the side of being on labor rather than being on management.
It's interesting that they tried to co-opt you.
Right? Yeah, they said, you know, I said, well, I don't even have, the director of labor relations told me I could have the job, you know, of one of the labor relations specialists, and which would have taken me out of the bargaining unit and have been, you know, been in a management position. I said, well, I don't even have an application yet. He said, well, we can get you an application and we can make it happen. And I had to tell him a few days later that my side was with the union and I was going to go be a business representative, and I decided not to be a labor relations specialist.
It didn't take you long to decide.
No, it really didn't. I knew where I wanted to be and what I wanted to do, and it worked out good. And then I was surprised when I got a call from Donnie Wharton, who was the administrative assistant to the vice president of the Cleveland office. He called me up and he said, you want to go on the Grand Lodge staff? I said, well, I don't know if I do or not, because those guys have to travel a lot, and I'm not sure that I want to do that. He said, there is travel involved, but he said, sometimes some of the guys travel more than what you would probably have to. Some of them like to be away from home, you know, and they like to travel. And he said, you probably wouldn't have to travel nearly as much as some of them do, you know, if you didn't want to. And so anyway, he said, think it over, talk it over with your wife. And he says, if you want to, he says, well, have you come into the Cleveland office and you can talk to the general vice president, Merle Pryor, about it and see what he has to say, you know. So I thought about it for a couple of days and talked to my wife about the thing, you know, and then decided to go and talk to him, see what they had to say. And they met me, Donnie Wharton and the vice president at the time, Merle Pryor, met me at the airport in Cleveland when I flew in. And we sat in the restaurant there and talked for a few hours, I guess. And he told me that his representative that handled the federal employees that dealt with the contract negotiations and organizing and what have you, he was going to retire and he needed a replacement for him. And if I came on, I'd have to move to Kentucky. And of course, that's like throwing a rabbit in the briar patch, because my folks lived in Kentucky. I had brothers and sisters that lived there, you know. And I said, well, going to Kentucky is certainly not going to be a problem, you know. And so anyway, we talked things over and I agreed to go on the Grand Lodge staff.
Your wife didn't mind leaving her relatives?
No, she did not. She did not. She was a real trooper. She enjoyed it. As a matter of fact, I told him at that time, I said, well, my children are in school here in Virginia, and I don't want to take them out of school during the middle of the year. I don't want to wait till next spring. He said, that will be fine, because he said, you need to be on 6 months before they'll pay for your move anyway, before they'll relocate you. But he said, in the meantime, you may have to go out to Kentucky and work some. But he said, you can either drive the union-provided car out there, or you can fly back and forth, whatever, you know. So it worked out well. And the following spring, when the children were getting out of school, we found a place in Lexington, Kentucky. We bought a home out there, and we moved out to Lexington. And my wife even says to this day, she's one of the greatest places we ever lived. She loved it while we lived there and just really enjoyed it. But we were there. I was servicing, while we were in Kentucky, I was working servicing contracts in Kentucky, working with the business representatives out there. And sometimes if they had an arbitration case that their schedule didn't permit them to handle, I would handle arbitration cases for them or whatever, you know. And so I worked Kentucky, and he would have me working back in Virginia. So I was working Kentucky, Virginia, and a few other assignments sometime that took me outside the states. But we lived there in Kentucky. I think we had a house there for 4 years. And then while I'm working in Kentucky, we have some problems that develop over in the Virginia area in my old district. And he has me assigned back over there because we had to put a local lodge or two under suspension, and I had to go in and was appointed the deputy for the international to handle their affairs. So I was assigned back to Virginia. My family's out in Kentucky. I'm working in Virginia most of the time and traveling back and forth to Kentucky to see my family. So that went on for several months, maybe a year. And finally I told him, Vice President at the time, Earl Price, said, you know, you got me working in Virginia, you're paying me per diem, all this travel back and forth. I said, if I'm going to be working in Virginia most of the time, why don't you transfer me back to Virginia, and we won't have to pay all this travel expenses and per diem, you know. And he said, okay, we'll do that, you know. So we ended up selling our place in Kentucky and bought a house back in Virginia and moved back to Virginia.
It's a good thing you liked both places, otherwise
yes.
You might have been mad.
Yeah, it worked good. No, it worked out good. So
So how did all those problems arise when you were gone such a short time in Virginia?
Well,
or they were in different parts of the...
The first local I got assigned back to was the local that was in the Norfolk Naval Shipyard, the machinist local. And I had nothing to do then when I worked in there because I was in the IBEW local doing electrical work,
right.
And this is the machine shops. And we actually had two locals in the shipyard at that time. We had inside machinists and outside machinists, two different locals in there. And one of them had, some of the guys in there had gone, done some bad things, got involved in drugs, and some of the officers, and they actually took money from the local lodge. And we had to suspend all the officers.
Mm.
And I took the local over and ran it for about year before we turned it back over to them. And the officers that were found guilty of wrongdoing, they were barred from ever holding office in the local again. And
did they keep their jobs?
Kept their jobs, because you can't take, when you can suspend them from their position in the union, but you can't affect their employment. So they
but
were able to keep their jobs.
The company would notice if they were involved in drugs.
Yeah,
and
yeah. But if they're not involved on government work, it's hard for them to get involved. This is outside, as far as we know. It was done outside. It may have been done some inside, but we didn't. That didn't affect us as a union.
Yeah.
It was outside. It was outside in our union affairs is where it affected us, you know. So we took action to remove the bad guys and put new guys in their place. And I put on an organizing campaign while we were there. Worked with a guy in the shop there, C.R. Brown, a great guy, and he helped me organize, and we had the membership. We took the membership from about, I think it was about 400 members at the time. We took it up to like 1,000 members during a year's time just by organizing ourselves within, you know. So the membership grew tremendously, and we had a real great functioning local lodge. Yeah, it was a big thing there.
Sure.
That we did. Yeah. And it worked out good. And
so that's in the late 70s.
Yeah, that would have been, because I went on in 77. That would have been, now that's probably into the early 80s now. We're into the 80s, early 80s when this happened.
Okay.
Because I worked in Kentucky for a while. I worked out there and back and forth to Virginia. I worked out there for a couple of years before I actually came back to Virginia to take over this assignment as deputy of the local lodge on behalf of the international. And then we had another local lodge that was being raided by the Teamsters Union over in Newport News, the Bendix local. And we went in there and fought off the raid there and beat the Teamsters in the election.
How'd you do that?
Well, it was, we had to go to a vote, and we beat them. We beat them at the vote, you know, and...
But what did people... What do you think the winning... What were the factors?
What got us in trouble there in Newport News was, just to be honest with you, was our representatives that were there servicing at the time were not doing the job that they should have been doing.
So that left the opening for the Teamsters to try.
The people got very disgruntled, and I was assigned in there to negotiate their contract, and we negotiated the contract. And it was kind of an unusual thing because we had a lot of members in there that were supportive of the Teamsters because of our failure to represent them properly in the past. And I remember the day we took it to a vote. I was in there negotiating the contract, and it was kind of an unusual thing. We had like a 39-month contract, but by law, you can only bar a challenge from another union for 3 years. So even though you negotiate a 39-month contract, you can't keep the union from challenging you and taking you to an election. So we actually prevented the election by going in and negotiating the contract prior to the end of the 36 months. So I went in and negotiated the contract, and we took it to a vote. But when we took it to a vote, it was like 3 months before the contract went out, but they was going to put the new contract in effect if it was ratified by our members. Well, we had a lot of these Teamster sympathizers show up at our meeting. As a matter of fact, the meeting was so ruckus because of all these sympathizers for the Teamsters that showed up to vote, and we can't keep them from being there because they are members of the Machinist Union.
Right, right.
But they're sympathizers for
the
Teamsters. Yes.
That you've just negotiated.
So I'm telling them at this meeting that, you know, you need to approve the contract. It has to be, when you vote for the contract, it has to be carried by, you have to vote, a majority of the people have to vote to carry the contract. And if a majority of you don't vote for the contract, then by our constitution, we'll have to take a strike vote. And that's what we had to do, because that day they voted the contract down.
So more than half of the people there,
yes,
basically weren't against the contract. They were sympathizing with the Teamsters.
Yes, yes. And that's why they voted the contract down. I said, now we're going to have to take a strike vote. By law, by our constitution, we're going to take a strike vote. And it really got ruckus in there. I mean, these people were mad. It got so bad, I had rented the, in Newport News there, I had rented the Ramada Inn. They had a big conference room that would handle like 400 or 500 people. It was a big, humongous conference room. And that's probably about how many we had there, because we represented almost 1,000 people over there at this Bendix plant. And it got so loud and so vocal inside there, people yelling and screaming and carrying on. And it was only me and the local lodge officers, and I had one other international representative there with me. And we were trying to conduct this thing. I had to appoint tellers to count the ballots on the election for the contract to make sure that we got a majority, if we did get a majority. And when they count them, they said, we don't have a majority. And I said, okay, we're going to have to take a strike vote. So I'm up the PA system, and I tell them, I said, you have voted the contract down. It's been rejected. So now we must take a strike vote, and it must carry by a 2/3 majority. 2/3 of you have got to vote for the contract, or you've got to vote for a strike, or you're going to have a contract, because based upon our constitution, if you don't vote by a 2/3 majority to carry a strike vote, then you automatically accept the contract, even though they'd already voted it down.
Oh, there's not another ballot.
That's it. No, that's it. That's it.
Goes.
Yeah.
Oh,
so you take two votes.
Interesting.
Well, that's where our constitution is.
Okay.
So anyway, I'm trying. In between this, the other Grand Lodge representative that was in there with me, Dad Smith, he's older than me, he's about ready to retire, and wasn't in the best of health. And he gets all upset, so he brings, because he hears all this allegation about people got in line and voted twice before, you know, and I didn't know that. It was allegations, I don't know if there's any truth to it or not, you know. So he takes a big old trash can and sets it right down in the middle of the auditorium there, and he says, put your ballots in here, we'll have tellers here to watch. So I'm out there telling the tellers, everybody line up. And I put tellers in the end of the line. I said, now, we've got tellers back here at the end of the line. We've got tellers up here watching the ballot box. And I said, I want to make sure that nobody, when they vote, when they go through this line, when they vote, they don't come back and get in line and vote twice. We want to make sure this is a pure vote. It's going to be accurate, you know.
This is the strike vote.
Yes.
Right.
So I'm out there getting people lined up. In the meantime, I've got a Teamster sympathizer. He's up on the stage on my mic. I've rented this building now for like $400. You know, I paid this for the organization's pay. He's up there on my mic telling the people what to do and what not to do. Well, my blood pressure goes up and I'm about to die. And so I go running down the aisle and I jump from the floor onto the stage. It's up like 3 or 4 feet up. I jump up there because this guy or me, him or me, one's got to go because I'm not going to allow this guy to run my meeting that I paid for, you know, or the organization is paid for. So anyway, he goes flying off the other end. And I tell the tellers from up there, then on the PA system, you stand in line out there, make sure that nobody gets back in line. I got this thing all orchestrated. Well, my other rep, he disappears. I don't know where he went. He's no longer in the building.
Oh, dear.
So anyway, and in the meantime...
He's the older one.
Yes.
Okay.
In the meantime, it has got so rough in there that on every door, there are one or two policemen. This lady that I had rented the building from, she thought that we were going to have a... She thought we were going to have a riot in this building, you know, in her building. So she's called the local police, and there's like policemen on every door. They can't come in because they're not members. We won't let them in the building, but they're on the doors, you know. So we go ahead, and everything goes smooth. It's not smooth, but it's smooth enough to get the thing done. You know, I keep tellers out there, make sure everything's done right. All the ballots ran, so I tell the tellers, count the ballots. Give me a written report, how many vote to strike, how many don't vote to strike, you know. And they come up after, we were waiting inside this building, so it takes an hour or so to count all these ballots on with these tellers. And finally, they bring their report up to me. And only about, I forget now what it was, I don't even think it was 50%, it was maybe like 40-some percent voted to strike, you know. So I stood up at the PA system. I said, brothers and sisters, you have a contract. You have failed to vote by a 2/3 majority to carry the strike vote, so you have a contract based upon the company's final, last, and best offer. And it's like all these people that are Teamsters sympathizers, they're mad, you know. But anyway, things go on. So I go out the front to check out to pay this lady. Everybody's leaving, you know.
Everybody leaves peacefully enough.
Yeah, it's okay because
loud,
the policemen, there's
peaceful.
Policemen all around, so nobody's going to try anything now, you know, because
right.
The policemen are there. And I was glad they were there, to be honest with you. And so I go to pay this lady, write her the check, you know, for the $400, where it was, you know. And she hears all this that's going on in there, I guess, because she wouldn't have called the police unless she thought it was
right,
bad,
unless
you know.
She heard something.
And she says, Mr. Combs, she says, I don't know what kind of work you do, but she said, I don't believe you get paid enough to do a job like this. I said, ladies, on days like this, you're absolutely right. I don't get paid enough, but somebody has to do it. So later that day, I called the other rep. He lived in Chesapeake, Virginia, there, not far from where I live. I called him. I said, Dez, I said, you disappeared. I said, what happened? He said, Coet, he said, after I put that trash can down there and put the ballots in, he said, I started getting these pains in my chest. He said, I was afraid I was going to have a heart attack. He said, I had to leave. I said, no problem. He said, how'd it go? And so I told him everything was okay, you know. But anyway, the Teamsters filed charges against us. They filed unfair labor practices charges against us because we had gone in and negotiated prior to the 36 months. We knew what we were doing because we knew they could, the day after the 36 months was up, they could have filed a petition with the National Labor Relations Board and taken us to a vote. We circumvented that by getting a contract. They filed their charges and took the National Labor Relations Board about a year to resolve everything, but they come back and said we handled things properly the way it should have been handled. The Teamsters was out and they got nowhere. So it worked out good for us. And we still got the local there.
Plant.
Yeah, 2461, and we're still there at the old Bendix plant. It's now Siemens, a German company, is taking over and running the thing, but we still got hundreds of members working in that same plant. It went well.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so you earned your keep.
Yeah, so, and I had another fight with the Teamsters. Another challenge, they raided us down at the Cherry Point, North Carolina facility, and this was like 2 or 3 years later. And I got assigned by my vice president to go in down there. He said, go in. He said, the Teamsters are petitioning for a vote. They're going to challenge us to the election down there to represent those employees. And it was about, that local down there had about, I think it was about 3,000 members of it, Cherry Point. So I went in down there, and he assigned a whole staff of other representatives to work with me, and we spent maybe 3 or 4 months in there fighting off that challenge, but we beat the Teamsters on that one also. We took that to a vote, and they didn't get nearly as many votes as we did, so we're still at Cherry Point, and the Teamsters are not there either. So.
And what was the key to that win, do you think?
I think there we had a good business representative there. I don't know why the Teamsters challenged us there. We had a good business representative, Terry Weatherton, and he had won so many cases for those people down there. Workman's comp cases, arbitration cases, safety and health issues, environmental differential pay. He had a history of winning these things. You know, I knew that. So we put together down there, we put together like a normally they don't like you for you to do this. When we put out flyers, they just want maybe like a half a page. They want a lot of white, just about a half a page, so people
right.
read it now.
Right.
But I started writing up.
Less is more.
I went to the secretary of the district office down there, and I said, we got to pull out all these cases that Terry has won, because I've got to show the members, and I've got to list everybody's name where he's won this case for me now. And we had like 2 full pages. Single space, you know, it's like, I forget now, it's like 30, 40, 50 cases, I don't know what it was, you know, he'd won. We put their names in there, and we put how much money. Some of them may only have been a few $100s, some of them were in the thousands of dollars. And we listed every one of those, you know, we'd put like 2 lines for each case, you know. We fill up, it's either 2 or 3 pages, you know. So I tell them we're going to hand bill this to everybody in there, because this was right before the election. And these other reps said, you can't hand bill something like that, that's too much. Writing. I said, no, you got to tell the story. So since I was in charge of the campaign, I overruled them. We put it out, you know. And of course, everybody's talking. You know, they go to Mary. Mary, did you get $3,200 for an environmental differential pay? Yes, I did. And we had every one of them. We had documented. So they was talking among themselves. You know, I didn't know that Bill got $700 for overtime pay on his case. I didn't know that so-and-so got this and so-and-so got this, you know. So they were all talking in there. We beat the Teamsters about 2-1 on that thing. We just tore them up. It was because we had a good servicing rep there. And why the Teamsters wanted to challenge us there, I don't know. But
and why people didn't have a better idea before the leaflet?
We just didn't publicize. You know, Terry was
that.
A good guy, but he was a low-key, quiet guy. You know, he'd just go win the case. And workman's comp, he would get involved in that for people, you know, get them a lot of back pay and environmental pay, you know, because there they were working inside tanks, and you're allowed environmental differential pay. If you're working on height, things that are up high without proper scaffolding, you're entitled to environmental differential pay, you know. And he knew the regulations, and he'd just file a case, and he'd pursue it till he got it resolved, you know, and then he'd just file it away, you know. And they didn't know the history of the thing. And
right.
when I put that out, they were all talking.
So interesting.
They
Do you
didn't.
Still have a copy of the handbill?
No, they may have it there at this local 2296 at Cherry Point. They may have it down there, but I don't have it with me. But,
See, you always need the story. I do this labor arts project,
yes.
and I'm always looking for handbills with great graphics or
right.
something striking
right.
that, you know, because generally you think that's what makes an impression.
Right.
That what you're telling me is the most boring one in the stack. If you get this right story, maybe the one that's the most convincing.
Yeah. But then my boss, Merle Pryor, wanted me to come to Cleveland, Ohio. Tom Buffenbarger, who's our international president now, Tom was Merle's administrative assistant, and he had left the Cleveland office to come to work at headquarters for some special job that they wanted to work at. Wimpensinger wanted to Buffenbarger to come to headquarters and work on this job. So Merle, this was in 1987, Merle, he kept, but 2 or 3 years, he kept asking me to come to the Cleveland office. I said, Merle, you have 9 states in the old Great Lakes Territory. You have 9 states. And I said, I'll work in any one of those 9 states. But Cleveland, Ohio, I've never heard anything good about it. I don't want to go to Cleveland. That's the last place. I said, if you want me to go to Michigan, Indiana, Ohio, not Cleveland, Kentucky, Tennessee, North, South Carolina, Virginia, Western. I said, I'll work in any state you want. I don't want to go to Cleveland. That's the last place I want to go. And he kind of tricked me. We got to Myrtle Beach in the spring of 87, and I'm checking in. He comes up to me. He says, hey, I got to talk to you. I said, what are you going to talk about? He said, well, he said, I'm shorthanded in the Cleveland office. He said, I need you to come in there next week and help me out a little bit. I said, well, I said, I'm supposed to be at Placid Harbor next week. I'm supposed to be here for school. No, I told him the week after that, I think. I said, the week after that, next week. I said, I'd come in next week, but the week after that, I have to be at Placid Harbor. He said, okay, he said, that'll be fine. Now. So I go into Cleveland the following week. On Monday, I fly in. The first day I'm in there, Merle sits down. He starts talking about these things he wants me to do. And he's just like, I'm believing all these things. I go back to the hotel room that night, and I'm thinking, there's no way in the world. I can't even scratch the surface during the week I'm here, you know. Now, he wants me to come in here. He told me to come in here for a short period of time because he was shorthanded. So I go back in the next day. I said, Merle, I said, you know, I kind of thinking about this last night. And I said, all this stuff that you've talked about, I was going through these notes. I said, there's no way in the world that's all going to get done this week, you know. I said, you're talking about projects here that's going to last for weeks, months. He said, yeah, Coet, he said, I know. He said, I got to have you work up here. He said, I told you, I won't change your assigned station. He said, you can stay in Virginia. But he said, I got to have you work out of this office. He said, you can fly in every week. And he said, you can go home on the weekend. I said, Merle, I'm a family man. I said, I got to have my family with me, you know. He said, okay. He said, you move your family up here. I'll make you my administrative assistant. And he said, you can live here and work here, you know. He said, otherwise, he said, you're going to have to commute back and forth. So I called Linda that night. I said, honey, guess what? We're going to be moving to Cleveland, Ohio. So I told her what happened. I said, I've got to work up here. I'm not going to work up there, and you all live in Virginia. So the two girls, they were in college in Tennessee, went to Tennessee Temple University, and they were home. I said, don't say anything to the kids about it. My son is a senior in high school. No, he's a junior. He's going to be a senior the next year. So I said, don't say anything to the children. We'll have a meeting when I get home this weekend, you know, and we'll tell them about it now. So I get home that weekend, and I tell the children, I said, we gotta sit down and talk, you know. So I tell them, I said, Merle has told me I'm going to have to work in Cleveland. Now, I don't want to work up there. My family live in Virginia. So I said, we're going to relocate to Cleveland, Ohio. You know, I said, as bad as I don't want to, we're going to do it because it seems like the least alternative that we have, you know. So I'm watching my son. He's sitting over there, and I'm asking the girl, I said, Deborah, the oldest, I said, Deborah, what do you think? She said, Dad, she said, we're away in college from September till June. Are we pushed for time?
No, we're fine. I'm just checking the machine. We're good.
And I said, she said, Dad, she said, we can go from Cleveland to Tennessee to go to college as easy as we can go from Virginia to Tennessee. Barb, she said the same thing, our middle daughter, middle one. And I'm watching Tim. I said, Tim, what do you think? Because I know he's going to be a senior next year. He said, well, Dad, he said, I really don't mind. He said, you know, David, that was his best friend. He said, David was a year ahead of him in school. He said, David's going away to college this year. He mentioned a couple of other kids. He said, they're going to go to other schools next year. He said, I don't mind going to Cleveland. I said, really? He just a real trooper about the thing, you know. And he went to Cleveland. I mean, we moved to Cleveland. And he told me after that year, he made the soccer team, he made the basketball team, played sports, both those teams up there in the school. He told me after that year, he said, Dad, this is the best school year I've had my whole year, the whole time I've been in school.
No,
so,
okay.
Yeah, he loved it. It worked out great, you know. And then he went off to Tennessee Temple the next year as a freshman down in college, and so it worked out great.
That's amazing.
And
yes,
we didn't want to go to Cleveland, but while we were there, it was really Linda and I both said, we love Cleveland.
What would have happened if you'd have just said, I can't come here?
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know what would have happened.
it's a good thing you didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I worked with Merle Pryor up until the end of the year, and then Donnie Wharton got named as a new general vice president, and he came to Cleveland to take over, and Merle Pryor got transferred over to the Chicago regional office, and I worked there in Cleveland for the next 5.5 years with Donnie Wharton as his administrative assistant. And we closed down the Cleveland office in 93, and I came to headquarters. And when I came to headquarters, they assigned me as the assistant director of the legislative department, and I worked with the director, and we lobbied on the Hill and lobbied Congress for various bills and what have you, and kept busy doing that. One time I went down there because President Clinton was in a bind on a particular bill and needed labor support, so the AFL-CIO called a meeting, and we went to the White House and met with Bill Clinton, and he came out and told us, he said, "I need your help." He said, they had a list of about 20-some congressmen. They said, "We need these guys turned around. We need you guys to do all you can." So we took assignments, different labor organizations took assignments on one or two or three congressmen that we would work on, and we worked on and got it turned around and got the bill. It was a budget bill for Clinton, they said, because if they win this one, they're going to go for the jugular vein, and we got to have it, so we was able to turn that around. So I went in and sat and chatted with Bill Clinton. He shook our hands and told him how much he appreciated us, and we got the job done and got the bill passed for him.
How did you do it?
Went and started talking to the various congressmen, and we
did you get assigned a congressman from a state where you had, from an area where you had a lot of members? I mean, was it that
I don't remember right now. I don't remember who it was right now, but whatever it was, we would get our people back in the district because we
wherever it was,
we
you
knew,
would have people.
We knew, yes.
And then
we
would
knew
get those
that
people.
The old saying, if a congressman gets, they said, one of the aides said, if the congressman gets one or two calls on an issue, it's not a big deal. But if he gets 10, 20, 30 calls on an issue, the lights go on, They start getting real concerned. And if he gets more than that, he gets more involved, So we knew how to turn up the pressure. We call our districts and local lodges and say, start sending the calls, the letters into this particular congressman on this issue, We need you guys to ring his bell and don't let up until we tell you to stop, or until the bill is passed.
Mm-hmm.
So we knew how to turn up the heat on him, and we were able to
it
do
worked.
That. Yeah, worked good. So we got the one, I even forget now who the congressman was that we was assigned to, the one that I had to go talk to, but we got the congressman turned around and he voted to support the bill, and we got the mission accomplished. Yeah, that's good. I only worked in the legislative department for about 6 months. I think at the end of that year, that would have been 93, I think it was January, I got a call from George Kirpus, and he said, Coet, he said, I need you to become the director of the government affairs, government employees department. And I knew John Meese was in there. I didn't know Meese was retiring. And he really wasn't. He had been asked to go over and head up the metal trades department, become the president of the metal trades department, Meese had. So George said, since I had come out of the federal government, George Kirpus wanted me to head up the government employees department. And I told him, sure, I would be glad to do that, So I left there and worked with our government employees for about 2.5-3 years. And I would go around and put on training classes at the various locals and districts where we had government employees, Norfolk, Virginia, Cherry Point, North Carolina, California, Seattle, Washington, Bremerton, Washington, where we had government employees, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, Ohio, Louisville, Kentucky, wherever we had government employees, I'd do down in Florida. I would go put on training seminars to train them how to become better shop stewards, better representatives, and how to...
It's a fairly different set of procedures than
yes.
for any other
government
shop steward.
It's entirely different. Because there in the government, you can't, it's not when the contract runs out, you can go on strike. You can't go on strike. So you have to learn how to negotiate and resolve things and get things done without the threat of a strike, because you can't do it.
Right.
And... work in the legislative process, that's very important to government employees because all their benefits are legislated, so they have to stay on top of that, So our job, my job as the director of the government affairs department, was primarily working with the business representatives. Sometimes I would handle negotiations for one of the business reps, or I may go out and handle an arbitration case, but it was primarily getting our people involved in knowing how to handle their problems and the proper people to contact and legislators and get things done that way, you know. So I spent 2.5 years or so doing that. And then one day Donnie Wharton come to me and he said, Coet, he said, I need a new personnel director, and he said, I want you to do it. And of course I'd worked for Donnie. As a matter of fact, he's the one who called me when I went on the Grand Lodge staff back in 1977. He was the administrative assistant for Merle Pryor, and I'd known Donnie. I'd known Donnie ever since I'd become a business representative, or before I was a business representative, I guess. And he was a great guy. And he come down and sat in my office and talked to me. He said, I want you to be my personnel director. He said, will you do that? I said, well, how long do I have to think about it? He said, well, you take 2 or 3 days, whatever you want to think about it. You know, we sat there and talked for a minute. I said, Donnie, I said, I don't need any more time to think about it. And then I said, you're the greatest boss in the world. I said, I'd be glad to work for you. And if you want me to be your personnel director, I'll be your personnel director, you know. So I went in personnel at headquarters, and they changed the title later to human resources director. But I went in there, and the last 8 years, I retired in July of 2005. So for the last 8 years before I retired, I was the human resources director.
And that means that you recruit and resolve things for everybody who works for the union.
Yeah, for the international.
For the international.
And we had...
How big is that?
That's, at that time, I think the largest number of employees we had was 220-some employees. And that included our regional offices, one in Canada, California, Dallas, Texas, Chicago, Cincinnati, and we had our regional office here at headquarters for the transportation department.
Did you feel like management?
Oh yeah, I had to. Yeah, because we hired people and had to fire people. So, and I worked with Placid Harbor down here on getting staff down here and dealing with issues, you know. And we had a shortage out in the field somewhere, if there was a shortage with some of our local lodge officers or involved with business reps or whatever, we had a shortage somewhere or some misappropriation of funds, our Grand Lodge auditors would go and investigate it. They'd get all the facts and figures together, and I would be assigned to go in and conduct a hearing to find out whether or not this person has actually committed a violation of our Constitution, you know. And I had to do that several times. Went to Canada a couple of times, out to California, Washington.
Was there ever a case where you didn't know what to do?
No. We always... it was,
the evidence was always
It was pretty
there,
clear, you know.
And
any time our auditors go in there, and they have the right to go in there and search the... bank records and look at everything I've done, they had the case built, so it was relatively simple. And it was just a matter of...
There's no case without evidence.
Right.
So you don't...
It was just a matter of bringing the person in, and it was bringing the person in and saying, this is what you've been charged with, this is what we have, and we'd have the Grand Lodge auditor put on the evidence that they had found, and we would ask the individual, what do you have to refute that? You know, and they could have an attorney represent them as long as they were a member of the IAM. They could use anybody they wanted as long as they were a member of the IAM to represent them at this hearing. But those were just things that we had to do to keep our organization clean, because if we found out somebody was cheating and we didn't do something about it, then we're guilty, you know. Sure.
Absolutely.
Sure.
Yeah.
So but anyway, it went good, and I enjoyed my stay as personnel director working for Donnie Wharton. And then when he retired, Warren Bart came in as a new general secretary treasurer, and I worked with him for a couple of years before I retired. But anyway, it's been wonderful. The union's been great. I think I may have told you yesterday the largest any contract I was ever involved in after I was a Grand Lodge representative, I was assigned into Norfolk, Virginia, where I had worked back in 1966, 67, and into 68. I was assigned in to head up negotiations for the Metal Trades Council for those 16 unions and about 1,000 employees, and about 10,000 employees working in there under the certification. And it took us about a year to hammer out a contract in there and got a contract and got it resolved. So it
was
good.
Had to manage the demands of all 16
unions. We only had, I remember right, we only had about six or seven people on the negotiating committee because all the unions were not big enough to have somebody. They had people sit on there based upon the number of members they had.
Right.
So our machinist union was represented because we were one of the biggest unions in there, the IUE, or IBEW, and boilermakers and some of the other skilled trades unions were represented on the committee. But I had a good committee, and they worked well with me, and we hammered out a contract in about a year's time and worked out good.
A huge number of people.
Oh, it is, yeah. And fortunately, when you're limited to what you can do, you know, as far as negotiations, but there are a lot of work rules that you can have impact on and make it better for the employees, you know, so it was good. It worked out good. So what else you need to know?
What did I forget to ask?
But the unions, you know, it's been wonderful to me. I could not have asked for a better career. It's every day I enjoy going to work. I know that when I worked at headquarters the last 12 years before I retired, I never had the feeling that, I wish I didn't have to go to work today. I never had that feeling. I just always enjoyed getting up, going to work. And it wasn't like it was work to me. It was just like, it's just like pleasure, you know, to do the work that I had to do. But then when I decided to retire, it didn't bother me to retire because I could walk away from it and still feel good about it, you know. I never said, well, I wish I hadn't retired. I've enjoyed retirement too, you know. So
yeah.
It's been good. Been very good.
What have you been working on since you retired?
Well, me and my wife are active in the church. We're involved in the church, and I play golf and do projects around the house and for my daughter and son-in-law and my son and other daughter that lives in Richmond, Virginia. I'll go there and work on projects for a week or two and things like that, you know. So, yeah.
Everybody keeps drafting you.
Yeah,
still.
Yeah, I enjoy it. Yeah, it's good. It's good. Just went out Thanksgiving with my son and daughter-in-law and two grandchildren out in St. Louis, and they moved into a new house, and he had about 8 or 10 projects he wanted me to work on, and I think we got them all done before the week was up. So it worked out good.
Really impressive.
Yeah, it was good.
I should ask you more, go back, I guess, to any political campaigns that you were particularly.
Any particular campaigns, yeah. While I was in.
Involved in, or stick out in your mind as either as moments when the machinist played role, or as moments when there was some kind of dissension among members about which way to go. I mean, on the national level, certainly there's been a lot of.
Yeah, I could tell you. Can you cut that off for a couple of minutes? Let me run to the restroom.
Absolutely, time to take a break.
I'll tell.
We're back.
One of the other things I probably didn't tell you there a minute ago, while I was human resources director for 8 years, any time that we had a sexual harassment charge filed against somebody out in the field or anywhere at headquarters or down here, I was assigned to investigate it. It was my job to go out and investigate it, make a report back to the international president, then he would rule on it. And we did that to try to stay out of court, you know, so we couldn't resolve those issues before they went into the courts, you know. So probably in the 8 years I was in there, I probably went out 6, 8, 10 times to investigate sexual harassment charges and make a report back to the international president. And I don't, to my knowledge, we never had one go on to court. I think we got them all resolved, you know. And, remember one in particular, we had this complaint come in from this lady down in Miami. She was the president of a local, and maybe the secretary, according to secretary, president of the local. She had a position in the local lodge office, local lodge. I think she was president. And she had, one of our Grand Lodge reps had showed up at the meeting, and he had used some awful language in there.
One of the Grand Lodge reps.
One of the Grand Lodge reps. So I was assigned in. She filed a complaint against him, sexual harassment, because he was very abusive to her with his foul language.
In the middle of a meeting?
Yes.
I mean, in
yeah.
public,
yeah.
entirely.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So I was assigned in, and when I go in, I tell him ahead of time I've been assigned to investigate, so he needs to meet me there in Miami at a certain date. And I have the other witnesses. I'm going to talk to all the witnesses. I'll talk to the one that filed the charges. I'll talk to all the witnesses, and then I'll talk to the individual. And so I got the facts from everybody, and it was very clear, you know, what had happened. And so I go meet with this guy, this Grand Lodge rep, and ask him. I said, "This is what she's saying. Is this what happened?" He said, "Yes." I said, and I called him by his name, I said, "You can't do that." He said, and this guy was already past retirement age. He's like, even at that time, he was like in his late 60s. He may have been almost 70 at that time. He worked, I think, even past 70. I said, "You can't do that." He said, "I've done that all my life." I said, "You can't do it that way anymore, because," I said, "that's not going to fly." I said, "You'll be in court." And I said, "If we don't do something about it, we'll be in court also. Because we'll be guilty also." And so I wrote my report up. I told him, I said, "I'm going to tell the international president exactly what I found on this thing, that this is exactly what you've done." And they wrote him a letter, reprimanded him, and told him if it ever happened again, he would lose his job. So those are the kind of things we got involved in. One time here at the harbor, I had a guy down here, and he was the bartender, and I got a sexual harassment complaint. And he was a good guy, but he didn't realize what he was doing. He would go around to the ladies, he would massage their backs. And most of them didn't mind, but this one lady, she told him, "I don't want you doing that to me, you know." And he'd do it again, you know. So she filed a written complaint, and I had to come down here. And I said, "John, you can't do that." He said, "Well, my family," he said, we're big on that, you know. I said, "It's okay with your family, but you can't do it here." I said,
"Well,
if
certainly
you do,
not when people say no."
No. I said, "If you do, you're going to lose your job. We're not going to have it." Because I said, "Once we become aware of it, we're going to put a stop to it. If you do it again, you're in history. You're out of here." You know? So, anyway, I don't think he really meant anything by it. But
sure
he just had to be told. You know, you don't. That's not the kind of thing you do, you know.
Have you ever had a time when people were falsely accused?
I think we had one case in Canada where the charges were not all that they had appeared to be on the surface, you know, and it wasn't as bad as what somebody was alleging, you know. We got the matter resolved, you know, but to say that there wasn't some wrongdoing, no, I don't know that I've ever been involved in one of those, because usually if it got to this level, there was something there, you know. Yeah, there was something going on, you know, so I had to go in several different times and tell people, you know, we just can't do that. We can't have it, you know. And they'd get a letter. After I did my investigation to the international president, he'd send out a report to them, you know. And,
he'd send down the final.
Yes, he made
decision.
The final. He made the
final
decision.
Final decision.
Yes,
so
yes. And of course, even after that time, they're allowed the people that's filing it. So if they're not happy with the results, they can go to court. You know. So what we were trying to do.
Very
we were trying
to
nip
to
it.
Your,
we were trying to nip it before it got to court, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as I know, I don't think we ever had one go to court. Yeah. But the other thing I was going to tell you, one of the things I was involved in, and when I was moved back from as a Grand Lodge rep from Kentucky back to Virginia, I was assigned as the Virginia, what they call it at that time, they'd call them state coordinator. So I would work with all the business, full-time business representatives in the state. We had two in Richmond, one in Roanoke, two in Norfolk. guess that was it. So I guess we had five, maybe one time we may have had three in Roanoke, I mean in Richmond, and maybe for a while we may have had three in Norfolk, Virginia. But anyway, work with those five or six representatives in dealing with any issues or any organizing we had in the state of Virginia. And so I was assigned in this business representative in Roanoke. There was a contract coming up at Clifton Forge, Virginia, and I was assigned in to negotiate the contract to help him out. So I did. I went in and negotiated the contract, and the guy before me was one of those old crusty guys, and he would scream and yell and cuss, you know, and bang his shoe on the table. He just did all kinds of things, you know.
The other machinist coordinator.
The other representative before me, he was that type of guy, you know.
Right.
Well, these girls were primarily a bunch of girls that we represented at this factory up in Clifton Forge, Virginia. A couple hundred people in there, and except for the maintenance people, I think most of the rest of them were ladies, you know, that worked in the plant. And they liked that. They thought if you didn't scream and yell and cuss the employer, you know, that you weren't doing your job. You know, well, that wasn't my style. I didn't do that, you know. We would lay out our demands, and we would try to walk through them, you know, and we'd try to show them the benefits of why we want it this way and not their way and what have you, know. And we reached an agreement, you know. And after we reached an agreement, and they voted and they ratified the contract, you know, so we had a contract. And afterwards, they come to me and they said they had given up some things. There was some language in there, I forget now what it was, but anyway, they had given up some language that they used to have, and had different language in the contract. And they come back to me and they said, this is the intent of what we've negotiated. I said, no, that's not the intent. I said, I know what the intent was, and what the company is saying is exactly right. What we negotiated is what they're saying, that's the intent of it, you know. So they're right on this issue, you know. Well, we're not standing for that. And they got mad at me, and they went and hired an attorney to represent them. That's bad news, because you can't spend local lodge dues money to do something like that to circumvent the contract or whatever, you know. So anyway, to make a long story short.
Oh dear. And just before you get there, do you think that part of that had to do with their feeling that you had been somehow not as effective as
yeah,
the Buster?
Yeah, they thought because
so
I would not yell and scream and would not really demean the company in front of them, you know, that I really wasn't as effective as the other guy. So anyway, they hired, it was actually two attorneys, one that had done some work for us up in Pratt & Whitney up in Connecticut years before. He was a labor attorney. They hired him and a guy out of Richmond, Virginia to represent them. They like signed a contract to pay these two guys like $10,000. Can't do it. It was wrong. You know, anyway, International Grand Lodge got involved in the thing, and they suspended the local lodge officers, filed charges against them for doing this, because what they were trying to do is circumvent the procedures for handling grievances and what have you through our grievance procedure and the business representative and the international to resolve the problems with the
right. If they thought you were wrong, they should have gone to
right.
the next level
yes.
instead of paying
yes.
$10,000
yes.
to the attorney.
So anyway, they hired these two attorneys to represent them, and I got appointed as the deputy when the lodge was suspended, all the officers were suspended. So under our Constitution, when you suspend a local lodge, the officers from their position, they have to appoint a deputy to go in and act on behalf of the president, and it's no longer democracy. It's one person.
It's like a trustee.
Yeah, it's one person controlling all the things.
Other unions,
you know,
call it
yeah.
a trusteeship,
yeah.
right? Yeah.
So anyway, I get assigned in, and I call a meeting to tell them that, you know, I've been appointed. Of course, they've got letters notifying they were suspended, you know, and certified letters going to them, you know, that they are no longer officers, and I'm the deputy, and I will conduct the meetings, and I will conduct the affairs of the local lodge, you know. And I go to this meeting that we've called, Clifton Forge, Virginia, and they have these two attorneys there. So somebody pointed out to me, I didn't know all the people, there was somebody pointed out to me, they've got their attorneys here, you know. Well, I know any meetings that we have, members only are allowed to participate in these meetings, you know. So I, up front with the auditor, I'm up front at the podium there, and I said, anyone in here that's not a member of the Machinist Union must excuse yourself and leave the room, because we're getting ready to conduct business of this union, and it can only be done with members of the IEM present. And this one guy, this attorney, is real nasty. He said, I'm a member of the bar, and I don't have to be a member of your Machinist Union. I said, well, if you're not a member of my Machinist Union, I'm going to ask you to leave so we can conduct business of this union in this particular meeting that we've called here for, you know. He said, I'm not leaving. The other attorney says, I'm not leaving either. I said, I'm going to ask you one more time to leave, and if you don't, this meeting will be over with. So he said, we're not leaving. So I just wrapped the gavel. I said, meeting adjourned. And so I get my briefcase, my auditor, Grand Lodge auditor, he gets his briefcase, and we start walking out. As we're walking out, the auditor, Irwin Kramer, he stops right at the aisle where these two guys are sitting. He looks down there, he said, did you say you're a member of the bar, or did you just come from the bar? So anyway, he just put a little gig in, and we left, and kept them under suspension, I don't know, 6-8 months, something like that. Got new officers in, you know, had them have elections later on, because those people were barred from, once they violate the Constitution, they're barred from holding office.
What happened to the attorneys? Did they get any money?
I don't think so. As a matter of fact, one of them who had done work for us in the past, we'd paid him when the employer up in Connecticut tried to break our union. We had hired him up there, and he'd gotten thousands and thousands of dollars from this union to represent our side of the case in court up there in Connecticut.
Right. Huh.
So he'd made big money off this organization. He came to headquarters, and International President Whippensanger was the president at the time. And he called me, he says, I've got this attorney so-and-so coming in. He said, I want you to tell me what happened. So I gave him the whole rundown on the thing, you know. And so he meets with this attorney, and this attorney saying, you know, he said, we were hired, and we understand now. They finally realize that they can't come in and circumvent the labor relations law, where that when unions are certified, they have this exclusive right to represent the people, you know, and an outside attorney can't just come in and say, well, Joe Blow has hired me to represent them, and I'm going to do it, you know. You can't do that under the labor laws, you know. So he come to headquarters, and Wimpensinger told me later that he actually cried in his office and asked Wimpensinger, he says, I beg you to forgive me. He said, we were wrong in what we did. We should not have done that, and Whippensanger said, you've already caused enough problem. Get out of here. Don't want to see you again. You'll never get any more money from this organization. Ran him off. And so that's the way it ended up. But as far as I know, I don't remember now, they may have gotten, initially the local may have paid them like a fee to get them in there to begin with. But after that, they never got any more money, because I had control of the checkbook after that. And I never wrote one check to them or paid them anything, you know.
Right,
so,
right.
Yeah. But, you know, we still got the local lodge. After a few months, those officers that did the wrong were suspended, barred from holding office, and had elections after that, got elected new officers, and they've been running the local lodge. We turned it back over to them, you know, and they've been running the local lodge. It's been going well ever since.
And the other people are still members?
They can be members. They just can't when they're barred
office.
From, when they do something wrong like that, once they're barred, they're usually barred for life. Now, sometimes it can be for a lesser period of time, you know, from holding office. But usually they're barred for holding office, especially if there's fraud involved or something like that. And I don't know about this case. They may have only been barred for X number of years, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember now. But anyway, the
mm-hmm.
local lodge is still going on, and everything is working well there.
It's important to have a system to resolve.
Yes, and to do it right. And that's all you have to do is just do the things
it
right,
should.
You know. And,
yeah. That's not something I ever dreamed of. I was asking you before we took a break about political campaigns that stood out in your mind over your years in the IAM.
Well, we got involved. You know, we got involved anytime there's an election. We would get involved, you know, on the endorsed candidates. If the FLCIO, Machinist Union being part of, they endorse somebody for Congress or Senate or whatever, that's who we supported, you know. And I got assigned out when I was at headquarters, well, I don't think I did when I was in Cleveland office, but when I came to headquarters the last 12 years before I retired, on the presidential elections, I would get assigned out into the field to work a particular congressional district to get out the vote. We could only go to our members. We couldn't go out to the public and try to get the public in, but we could go to our members and tell them, you know, here are the issues. And that's really what we're trying to do. We're trying to educate our members on the issues.
Yep.
And then get them to turn out on election day. You know, so I was involved in the last, before I retired, the last two presidential elections. I was signed out to Kentucky one time, worked out there for month and a half before the election, went out to Iowa one year, worked in the campaign out there prior to the election, and just to educate our members and to get them out to vote on election day, you know, that was the big issue, what we were assigned to do.
And was there ever a time when there was a real difference in where you were in the union between who people wanted to work for and the AFL endorsement?
I'm sure, no, not as far as being out in the public. I'm sure we've always had members that vote their feeling, you know. They know
mm-hmm.
that they vote a secret ballot, and they do these polls all the time, you know, and they say, you know, 70% of the members voted for the endorsed candidate, but 30% didn't, or vice versa, or 60%
mm-hmm.
voted for the endorsed candidate, 40% did not, you know, and I don't know.
But it doesn't cause a public, or not a public, but a...
No, you don't know that. You don't know that. I mean, sometimes you'll run into people at the meetings that say, you know, I think we're stupid for endorsing such and such. And we say, well, you know, we are a union. We're a democratic union. And if our membership endorse a particular candidate, that's who we're going to support, you know. And you may have disagreements with that. You may have certain issues, but... That's just the way we are. We're a democratic organization. That's who we support, you know. And sometimes you'd have disgruntled members, you know, but it never got to the point where it was a big,
mm-hmm.
full-blown issue or anything
mm-hmm.
like that. But I'm sure we always had members, always, and we always will have members that don't support the endorsed candidates, you know. But I think we, by educating our members and then getting them to actually participate on election day, I think it has a great impact on the outcome of elections, you know.
Do you remember when the singer became president?
Yes. Yes, I do. And that was a great thing for the organization.
How would you describe how you saw things change from your chair or car or whatever?
You know, the biggest change was, the biggest change, and I was a, so I was a business rep when he first became the international president, and Red Smith was the president before him, and the biggest change I saw was Wimpensinger was much more out in the public making his speeches and rallying the troops and getting people going in the right direction, you know, and he was very, very progressive and I think ahead of his time, and loved the man, thought he was just a great union leader, you know, but he got out and got involved in the issues and things that would help working men and women and talk those issues up, and he was able to get a lot of coverage, media coverage that we had never gotten in the past, you know. So he was an out front guy and a good guy, you know, so great guy.
He himself at least made all kinds of coalitions with other labor and progressive groups.
Yes.
Was that something that changed life as a business rep
I don't think it changed life. I think it was what needed to be done all along. He just had a way of putting it together, and he knew that labor union standing alone we're not going to affect everything the way we would like to see it affected in a positive direction. We've got to join coalitions with other groups to make things happen, you know. And I think that was his goal. And I think for the better part, it happened under him, you know. We did see the need. Our eyes were open that we can't just say, well, we're a labor union and this is our endorsement and we don't care about anybody else. We need to work with other groups and make sure that when we get together, that we're all singing from the same hymn page and we're all marching in the same direction, you know, for the same cause. So it was a good thing. It was great. Yeah.
And you think it really influenced your...
Oh, yeah. No doubt about it. Our union was...
Every territory you were involved in, you could see a difference in the...
Yeah. People, you know, you'd always have people say, well, do we really need to pay the money for that jet, you know? So, well, whether we do or we don't, we've got it, and it's a way for him to reach a lot more people and be in a lot more places than he would otherwise if he has to depend on public transportation. He's not going to be in nearly as many places as he would, and he's always welcome where he goes, you know, and so I think it's a good thing, and we keep talking, you know, it's good, but we always had some people that were disgruntled, said, why are we spending that kind of money for that, you know, and their thought was, just keep on doing things, we've always done things this way, you know, let's keep on doing them this way for the rest of our lives, you know, but he was progressive, and he was probably, I'm sure, ahead of a lot of people who were thinking, you know, and they didn't see the need for it, but it wasn't something that was, it didn't cause a major issue at the conventions or anything like that, you know. So it was a good thing.
I want to ask a little bit about that. You've lived in a lot of communities, but even so, you come from a labor family. But so in the communities that you're in, is there support for for labor and for unions? I mean, have you and your family mostly lived in places where most of the neighbors were on the same page?
No, I can't
not
say.
Not so much.
I can't say that... most people are not, because I know my wife, she would go to various meetings, and then when they found out that her husband is a union representative, you know, they would like kind of withdraw a little bit, you know. So most communities that we've lived in, now there's, you know, there's working class people there, and we seem to be close to them, and we're all on the same page, you know, most of the time, but a lot of times, I know my wife, she's experienced it more than I have, that people find out, well, your husband works for the union, and they start thinking mafia and corruption and stuff like that, you know, and she's had to tell them, that's not the machinist union, that's not my husband, you know, we're not that, that's not that type, you know. But as far as living in a community where everybody's thinking and going in the same direction we are, no, I haven't seen that, you know. There's some, you know, we have some neighbors that are blue-collar working people, and they think like we think and do like we do, but it's not always that way, you know.
And you've been involved in a couple of strikes over the years.
Yes.
And then the same question, what happens when you go out on strike in terms of getting support from outside the union?
Well,
I guess I should go back and ask that about a particular instance.
Yeah, I haven't been on a long strike, you know, where you really, I guess as the strike progresses longer and longer, then you need more support like that. You do need others involved, you know, when you try to educate others why you're doing, because usually what appears in the paper is not good press for people that are on strike. It's not good. So we try to educate them on that, but my biggest thing was trying to get them not to strike to begin with, you know. I had a group in Norfolk, Virginia one time, worked Newport News, Virginia, worked for a government contractor, and I negotiated the contract, and we were dealing with a very tough employer, and I knew that. And I told the people when we come to the ratification meeting, I said, you know, it's not as good a contract as we would like. It's not what we wanted, but it's the best we can get at this time, you know, and I recommend that we accept the contract. And they voted it down.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, as we explained to you what it was, we're going to have to take a strike vote now. And we had a lot of people in there that was charged up. They were mad about some issues.
About the Teamster, it was also.
No, this has nothing to do with the Teamster. This was another one.
Oh,
this is a different one.
Oh, sorry.
A different
okay.
One. So the people are mad about some issues at work, you know, and we didn't get them resolved to their satisfaction. So they vote the contract down. And I said, now listen, this employer is very tough. And don't vote to go on strike unless you're willing to stay out there the long haul, because we're not going to resolve this thing within a day or two. This employer's, he's very anti-union, and he would like to get rid of the union altogether, you know. And he's the kind of employer that will try to hire new people to take your place. So I said, don't vote to go on strike unless you can stand up when he starts hiring new people, because I'm afraid this guy will do that. I think he'd made the threat before, you know, I'll replace him, you know.
Yeah.
And anyway, I wish I could have been more persuasive in telling them this, because they voted to strike. And they
went
out.
Two-thirds vote?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It carried by more than that. This was like a...
Really?
I forget now what it was. It seemed like it was 75-80%. You know,
wow.
They were...
They were ready.
Yeah. They had a few...
They were mad.
They had a few local people there that were just fired up, and they wanted to get this company, because this company had treated them bad, you know. They really wanted to... They really wanted to bang them good, you know. And so I said, you know, don't please think about this thing, because this is a tough employer, you know. And anyway, they voted to go on strike. So I think the contract ran out at midnight that night. And the next day, they were on the picket lines. We had them shut down, you know. And after one day, the company ran an ad in the paper. Like, we're out one day. They ran an ad in the paper. They were started hiring replacement workers. So it was only one day. And they were calling these people. They may have sent them all a notice. If you don't show back up to work by such and such a date, and they only gave them like 1 or 2 days. If you don't go show back up by this date, there will be we will hire a replacement to take your place. Well, I'm going over there on the picket line with these people, you know, and there's a lot of people on the picket line, and they're rolling around, and they called me off to the side. They said, look, you got to do something, because if you don't get this resolved, I'm going back to work. I said, you didn't listen very well when I told you that this employer may hire replacement workers. Well, I didn't think you would do that, you know. And so I had several. They wouldn't say it out among themselves, because they were too embarrassed to talk among themselves, but they kept calling me off the side. I got to talk to you. I got to talk to you. So I walk around, and I've got several people that's talking, and they're all telling me the same thing. I'm going to cross this picket line. I'm going to go back to work if you don't get this thing resolved. So I took a reading on these people, and my gut is churning, because I'm afraid I'm going to lose this whole thing, because this company is just, they're just bad enough to do that, you know. And so I called the mediator up in Richmond, Virginia. I called him and said, can you get a meeting with the employer tomorrow with me to see if we can resolve this thing? And one of the things that the employer had wanted to do was, he had wanted to, we had union dues check off in the plant. He wanted to eliminate that. Well, you can't go out and collect dues individually. If you don't have check off, you're in bad shape, you know. So I got him initially to keep that in there. But we had a provision in there also, since it's a government contract, we had a provision in there where that if they come to work there, they must become a member of the union, because you can't do it in Virginia under a right to work statement on a federal installation. You can do that under a federal contract. If it's on a federal enclave, you can negotiate a provision that says they must either be a member or they must pay dues. They don't have to be a member, but they must pay an equivalent dues, you know.
Services there.
Yeah,
yeah,
right. So anyway, this meter, he calls me back. He says, I can get a meeting tomorrow at such and such a time, like tomorrow afternoon, you know. It's okay. And it was like the following day is when the employers were going to start replacing them. We went into negotiations at 6 o'clock that evening down in Hampton, Virginia. And we negotiated till like 6 o'clock the next morning. And I'm knowing myself, I've got a bunch of people here that are weak. They will not stand up. You know, when they start hiring replacements, I'm going to lose them all, and we're going to have a bunch of replacements in there.
Right.
I've got a bunch of people out on strike with nowhere to go, you know. So we negotiate all night long, and I finally get the employer to put that provision back in there, that they don't have to be a member, but they must pay an equivalent dues. You know, we got the check off. And I forget now what I got, two or three other little things, you know, nothing big. And after negotiating all night long, I call another meeting. We have another ratification meeting. Bring it back and present it to them, and they accepted it. And it's a good thing, because had that company knew what I knew, if that company knew how weak they were, and I didn't tell anybody, if they knew how weak those employees were,
right,
they'd have held out. If I'd have been the company, I'd have held out.
Right.
Yeah, I held out. They'd have broke our union. We wouldn't be there. We'd have lost it all that week, because they'd have hired replacements. Yeah, we could cut picket lines up, you know, but they hired replacements. We'd have been through. So anyway, that local is still there. And fortunately, we saved the thing, because I didn't tell anybody that I knew what everybody was telling me individually.
Right.
I didn't tell anybody else that that's the feeling of the whole group just about here. So we were able to salvage that group and made it work, and they're still there today, you know. So that was a good thing. But people are funny, you know. They get mad on some issue, and they want to bloody the employer's nose. But then when it turns around where they're going to get hurt, sometimes they have a change of heart. It takes a strong labor person to go out there and say, I'll walk the picket line, even if they're going to replace my job. If they're going to hire a replacement, I'll still walk the picket line. It takes a pretty strong person to do that. And
it's not clear that that's a long-term,
right,
effective,
yes,
strategy.
Yes. Yeah. But I've been involved in a few strikes, but our goal is always to try to get it resolved without going to a strike.
Without it going on too long.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, so that's where I was asking a question about community support or any outside support,
right,
during a strike.
Right.
And basically what you're saying is the strikes you were involved in were short,
yes,
and dramatic.
Yeah, we had one in Kentucky
really
that was long. Matter of fact, they ended up closing the plant. We had some women in Corbin, Kentucky, the business rep there. They were low paid, and I had, before I was servicing in Kentucky, they were an individual union, they were not in a district. So that means that Grand Lodge had to service them. We had to negotiate their contract, handle grievances and arbitration case. So our goal was to put all those satellite individual locals, put them in a district and have the district service them, and it worked out better that way. You know, Grand Lodge didn't have to keep a rep there all the time, you know. Because we didn't have that many to. Anyway, I got this one local in Corbin, Kentucky, to go in District 153 in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And the business rep came in and negotiated the contract. And they went on strike. And these women were tough. I mean, they brought slingshots and steel ball barrels.
Ball bearings
and shot the windows in the plant.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a little shack they built out by the entrance where you go into the factory. And that's where the picket stayed all the time, you know. It was shut down. There was nobody going in and out of the plant. All the employees were out. It was locked up solid. And the girls had been out on strike for like, I forget, a month or so, maybe longer. And they even put, it's like in the fall of the year, September, October, they brought a Christmas tree and put it on top of their little shack. And they said, we'll be here to Christmas if that's what it takes, you know. So they were very adamant. They were very solid in what they were doing.
Huh.
So the company decided they're going to hire strike replacements. They couldn't get any in Corbin, but the next town over, there's another adjoining town, they got a couple of guys, shady characters, to come to cross the picket line. So these guys come out there to cross the picket line. These girls said, where are you going? The plant's closed, you know. We're on strike, you know. Well, the company has hired us to come in here to work, and we're going to work, you know. The girl said, you're not going in there to work. These girls are tough. They've got baseball bats in, so they start hitting this car. And they knock out headlights, and they bang up the car. And these guys turn around and leave. Well, in the meantime, the plant manager, he calls the state police. And the state police come up there, and our business rep's there. I wasn't there. The business rep is there. and he knows that he has a very good relationship. He's a good politician, so he knows the state police, and he tells the state police, yeah, there's some gangsters come up here, you know, and got in, wanted to fight with these girls, you know, and anyway, they run him off, you know. So while the state police is there, there's a big crowd of women there, 30, 40, 50 women there, you know. In a few hours, here come these two guys back. One of them is sitting up on the hood of the car, and he's got a shotgun.
Ooh.
They're going to cross the picket line, you know. This company's told them to come to work. He's going to cross. He's sitting up on the hood of the car with a shotgun, and the other guy's driving.
Yes.
And the state trooper, they don't know the state trooper's there. I don't know why. Maybe the car may have been parked on the side. I don't know. But the state trooper's in the crowd with our ladies. And as these guys come up there, they're getting their way. Their car's driving through this crowd of women, you know, and this guy's got this shotgun. The state trooper steps out of the crowd with his .357. He puts it right behind this guy's ear. He said, I'm a state trooper. And he said, you're under arrest, and give me the shotgun. And he took the guy's shotgun and arrested them both and put them both in jail. And nobody else crossed the picket line, but the company ended up, they were so adamant that they wouldn't give any pay increase, they closed the plant down. The thing went out of business.
Oh.
Went out of business.
How long were they out on strike before?
They were out for like 3 or 4 months before they finally ended up closing the thing down altogether, you know. Yeah.
That's really sad.
It was. It really was. You know, you hate to see that.
Yeah. But that's amazing. The state trooper came.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Came in. So when the state trooper came, the women hid their baseball bats, I'm guessing?
Probably. I would imagine they did. So. No, officer, we're just here keeping people from crossing our picket line, you know.
Just standing here picketing.
Yeah, that's right. But they were a tough bunch of ladies.
Well, some good stories. What did I forget to ask you?
What did you forget to ask me?
I know. I was asking about community support for the strikes. But the other thing that's a related question is, did you belong to church your whole life?
Always.
In your different communities?
Yes,
and
always.
Was there ever any...
No.
Were those two totally separate sectors of your life?
Yeah.
All the way through?
Yeah,
there was never any crossover between your labor?
No. The churches that we belong to are independent Baptist churches. They're very conservative. So they do not, you know, they're not going to get out there and get involved like some churches on labor issues or something.
Mm-hmm.
They just won't do that, you know. So they've never gotten involved in things like that, to my knowledge, you know. So.
And you've never had a situation where you wanted to go to them and say, can you please help?
No.
With this?
I don't think I ever did, because
yeah.
they would not. It wouldn't be like there's a bunch of people out of that church that's out on strike, you know. The people that were on strike were not, they were outside of the church. They were not in the church,
they
you know.
Connected
never,
in
yeah,
any
never,
way. Yeah,
never had that issue where there was a bunch of people. You know, I think if there had been people in the church that were on strike, then I think you could have asked for the support and probably gotten it, you know. But for them to support somebody that's not in the church, no, they
doesn't
couldn't.
Make any
no,
sense.
No, they wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And community support, we always said, you know, anytime we have a strike, we need to get the community involved. We need to get people involved, you know, to support the strike, you know. So it's always been an effort to get as many involved as we could, you know, to
mm-hmm.
help out. Yeah.
So what did your wife do in these years?
Well, she stayed at home with the children, raising the children, keeping them in school and things like that while I was working on the job up until our son, when we were in Cleveland, Ohio. His senior year, he went to high school there, and she pretty much stayed home when I would go on the road, except in the spring she always went with me. We would go to a staff conference, and we'd usually have a staff conference that would last almost a week. And most of the time we'd go to Myrtle Beach, sometimes other places, but somewhere within the territory. Myrtle Beach seemed to be like a place that all of our business reps and Grand Lodge reps like, so we'd have a staff conference for a week down at Myrtle Beach, usually in April or May, one each spring, and all the spouses would come there, and we would have probably with the business reps in the nine states, and the Grand Lodge reps, and our Cleveland staff, we probably have anywhere from 50 to 75 representatives there, and then they'd have their spouses. So we'd have a pretty good size staff conference at Myrtle Beach once a year, and that was always good. And then we, in the meantime, each state council would have what they call a state council machinist meeting twice a year, spring and fall meetings. So from the Cleveland office, we'd go out to those meetings, and at those meetings, we'd do the educational things on politics, endorse candidates, you know, educating our members on the issues and trying to make sure that the locals that were represented there would go back and educate their members on the issues and then turn the people out to vote on election day. You know. So we spent the state council meetings, the spring and the fall would be educational things for us to train our officers and members that were there, delegates that were there, to go back and get their members involved, you know. So it was a good thing.
So most of your friends were in the union?
Yes. Yeah.
And
yeah.
A lot of your wife, like a lot of your family friends. Did your wife make friends with the... Did she feel a part of it?
Oh, yeah. She didn't at first. When I first got involved with the union, her dad had been a truck driver, and he was a non-union truck driver with overnight transportation and out of Richmond, Virginia. He ran out of Virginia Beach, and the Teamsters tried to organize overnight transportation, I guess, several different times. And I guess there were some incidents where there were windows broken out in the vehicles, you know, and I don't know if it was the organizers did it or if it was company reps that did it to try to make the union look bad. You know, I don't know what it was, but anyway, he had a very dislike for unions because the company had told him that the unions are bad, you know, and they kept the unions out. So when my wife and I started getting involved with the union, she had some really reservations about what I was doing, you know, but I convinced her that it was a good thing. And then when I started getting involved, I would take her to some of the, if I was doing an organizing meeting somewhere, I'd take her and let her sit in on the organizing meeting, and where I'm educating the people, trying to show them the benefits of having a union, and they're going to be able to have a say and a vote in their working conditions and their pay and their benefits and things like that, you know. And they would tell their horror stories about the things that had gone on in their particular plant or facility, you know. And my wife heard all this. So it wasn't long until she was the greatest union supporter in the world. She thought, you know, that, and she does today, that there's nothing like labor unions, you know, but they have to be run properly and done right, you know, and that's what I try to do always, is make sure that things are done in proper order, you know. And but my wife, she went from anti-union to a very strong, positive
strong union supporter.
Yeah, she thinks there's nothing like labor unions. She's proud of unions today.
So what did I forget to ask? Did we leave things out?
I don't know of anything that you have not covered. If there's something else you can think of, I'll try to answer it.